Good morning, everyone. In the name of God, I bid you welcome to this place and time of prayer. On behalf of the congregation of Port Wallis United Church in Dartmouth, welcome to our Sunday morning worship service.
Bienvenue à tous les gens qui nous joignent en français ce matin, les gens qui viennent de chaque coin du monde. Nous vous souhaitons le bienvenue à cette église Port Wallis United Church à Dartmouth, en Nouvelle-Écosse, au Canada. Bienvenue.
Fáilteoir gur na húlla duine bhí aicinsa an san gaile go nua, go leis a thaisín as na Brunswick, as an Alpa Nua, as an Alpa, agus thaisín go bhí cuir sin fáilte orbh a húlla an a thiog an Yochalish Port Wallis United.
And in the language of the original people, we bid you welcome to this land. Jilastich, welcome. And we turn it over now to Tamsin for the acknowledgement that we're meeting in the land of the Mi'kmaq.
The United Church is determined to right the wrongs that have been done by the Church to Indigenous peoples over the last several hundred years. And it is in that spirit that we acknowledge that we are meeting in Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. As we move to the table, will you join me in the liturgy for the lighting of the Christ candle? Please say the words along with me as you light your candle at home.
You, O God, are light shining in the darkness of the universe, guiding us onward from what was to what can be. May this candle, whether lit or unlit, remind me of your presence and bring me comfort in every day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Will you join us in the call to worship? Come, angel, and come, visitor. Come now and be our guest. Come, Jesus, from your dwelling place. Stay here and take your rest.
Surround these walls with faith and love, that through the nights and days, when human tongues from speaking cease, this house may echo praise.
Amen. Let us worship God.
This is the day that God has made. We will rejoice and be glad. This is the day that God has made. We will rejoice and be glad. Singing hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. We will rejoice and be glad. Singing hallelujah.
And now the prayer of approach. God of infinite love, compassion, and mercy, gather us together in the power of the Holy Spirit and concentrate our thoughts on Christ. Join us in the great communion of your people throughout the world and throughout time, that we may receive guidance, encouragement, and strength to serve you and become more fully your living presence in our place and time. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Adam, will you lead us in hymn 145, Draw the Circle Wide?
Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song, no one stands alone, standing side by side. Draw the circle wide. Now the still point of the circle, round whom all creation turns. Nothing lost but held forever. God's gracious arms. Draw the circle wide. must be our song. No one stands alone, singing side by side. Draw the circle wide. Let the dreams we dream be larger than we've ever dreamed before. Let the dream of Christ be in us, open every door. Draw the circle wide.
Our scripture lesson this morning is taken from Mark's Gospel, beginning to read in the 6th chapter at various verses 30 to 34, and the later on, 53 to 56. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all that they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to his disciples, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot to all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret and anchored there. As soon as they got out of the boat, people recognized Jesus. They ran throughout that whole region and carried the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages, towns, or countryside, they picked up the sick and placed the sick in the marketplaces. They begged Jesus to let them touch even the hem of his garment. And all who touched it were healed. There ends the lesson appointed for today. All thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.
I have a visitor who wants to see you again. Just a moment. Okay, say hi, Seamus. Are you shy? Oh, Seamus is shy. Don't be shy, Seamus. Well, yes, there's going to be people see you, a whole lot of people. And yes, people are going to come running to you and want to hold you. That's just what happened to Jesus. And you're no better than Jesus, but you work for him. I know you do. And I know you care for people just like he does. Yes, I know. Jesus said to the people at that day, you know, go away and have a rest for a while, because they were tired of the crowds too. And Seamus is kind of tired of the crowds. He just wants to be by himself for a bit. I wonder, did you ever have to get away from everybody and just to be by yourself for a bit? And I want you to know when you do, when you have to do that, and sometimes even as adults we have to do that, I want you to know that God sometimes just holds you, like I'm holding Seamus. And he says, we'll get through this, things will be okay. And that's what Jesus is kind of doing to his disciples this morning. He said, okay, I know you're tired, I know you don't like the crowds, I know you have to just get away. So God's holding the disciples this morning, like I'm holding Seamus. And when you have to get away from the crowds, God's going to hold you too. I want you always to remember, when you have to have time by yourself, go, get away from the crowds. Go and be held by God. Isn't that right, Seamus? Yeah, okay. Very good. Will you pray with me? Okay, you want to pray too? Okay, you whisper in my ear. In peace, dear God, I come to you. Through Jesus Christ who makes me new. And while I run or play or rest, be with those whom I love best. Guide me in your holy way as you walk with me each day. Amen. See, I told you you'd feel better if you just got away from everything. That's what a vacation is all about, Seamus. You just get away from the crowds for a few moments. Okay? Yes, you can tell them. Do it. Yes. Okay. See you. Bye-bye. Have a good week, people. The hymn is Jesus, You Have Come to the Lake Shore, number 563. Do you want to sing? Yeah. Okay. Let's let Adam lead us. Jesus, You've Come to the Lake Shore.
Jesus, you have come to the lake shore, looking neither for wealthy nor wise ones. You only ask me to follow humbly. Oh, Jesus, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling, spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shore, I'm behind me. By your side, I will seek out the sea. You know so well my possessions. My boat carries no gold nor no weapons.
Let us pray. May the words in my mouth and the meditations in all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Be prepared in life. The paparazzi will chase you. While we often think of the paparazzi as being photographers who chased after celebrities and other famous people to get photographs of them, the word itself comes from an Italian dialect word that describes a particularly annoying noise, like that of a buzzing mosquito at night in your dark room, something you can't get rid of. And even if you can't hear it, you know that it's always there, the paparazzi. In the modern world, it can be anything that is omnipresent, that is always there around you, that haunts you even when it is silent. As we refer back to the gospel, in both sections of the gospel, we see the presence of the paparazzi of an earlier time. In the first section, we read the words, "But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns to get there ahead of them." The paparazzi. In the second section of the gospel, we read, "And as soon as they got out of the boat, the people recognized Jesus, and they ran throughout the whole region and carried the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was." Wherever he went, the crowds were chasing him. They were the paparazzi of the day. And Mark has that wonderful line, wherever he went. In the preceding chapters, Mark recounts a series of events and craftily sews them together by the use of numbers. A girl who was 12 years old is raised from the dead. A woman who had a flow of blood for 12 years is miraculously healed. And after feeding the crowds, the disciples gathered up 12 baskets of leftover food. This is typical of a gospel, something that is meant to be remembered, where one key word is the lead into the next story to be remembered, and somehow it all sews together until it all starts to make a pattern that is seen. Mark also uses phrases or expressions to lead us into the next passage of the gospel story. And in the gospel, Mark says, Jesus is touching people with his words and healing them spiritually. And now they all want to touch him and be healed, physically, mentally, or emotionally. The woman with the flow of blood is healed simply by touching the hem of his garments. And in the gospel lesson for today, they bring their sick to Jesus that they may touch the hem of his garments. And all who touched or were touched were healed. In the Gospel of Mark, these events are spreading the fame of Jesus throughout all the land, and he is being hounded by the crowds. The paparazzi are after him. Now, none of us will ever probably be bothered like that. But for us, the paparazzi, that annoying, buzzing sound that's always there, takes different forms. Remember that the paparazzi are not just photographers. Today, the paparazzi take the form of schedules, of appointments, of work responsibilities, of cell phones, something that are always omnipresent and are always there to haunt us. I have watched many of you be harassed and hassled to the point that you're almost ready to break because of the modern paparazzi. Too many demands, too many expectations, not enough time, no free time, not enough money, no money. How often have I heard people say, I've never been so busy in my whole life since I retired. Or, I've never been so tired in my whole life since we've had children. Or, work called the other night and the cell phone was by my bed and woke me up. Or, I went into my kid's room the other night and she was dead asleep with the cell phone in her hand. You know that it has reached the paparazzi stage when you can't lay down your cell phone, when you can't leave your scheduling, when you can't be away from work, when you can't leave for a day and go off into the hills and be alone. Or you know you're being hounded by the paparazzi when you can't turn off your cell phone, or when you misplace it and you enter into that massive panic mode of, where is it? Because you can no longer remember life without it. How often can I ask you, can you remember so-and-so's cell phone? You say, well, or cell phone number. You say, well, I take that away. Can you remember the number? Probably not. The paparazzi in our worlds do not necessarily come in the form of flesh and blood, but they equally chase us and equally haunt us. What we don't pick up in the gospel lesson is that in the first portion, it's all about Jesus and the disciples. And Jesus is recognizing the exhaustion that they experience by being out among the people, by being chased by the people hounding them. They don't even have time to eat. They are being chased by the paparazzi. So many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, says Mark's gospel. And Jesus looks at them and says to his disciples, come with me by yourself to a quiet place and get some rest. Jesus is trying to take them out of that busyness just to rest in God. Jesus recognized that his disciples at that time, as he recognizes that his disciples at this time, are tired, worn out, fatigued, exhausted, completely empty, and wanting to go home. He knows that they can't go on like this, just as he knows that we can't continually go on like this either. So he sends the disciples away. Go across the lake. Go away. Get away from the paparazzi. Go and find a vacation. Go and find some rest. Of course, what often happens to exhausted people is they can't let go. They're so tired, they can't escape. They feel that it all depends upon them, that the world, that the company, that the job won't function or can't function without them. The disciples get out on the lake. They start to try to do what Jesus asked them to do. And a storm breaks out. A storm of controversy breaks out. Probably over who was doing more or who was doing what was needed or what the salaries was. You know how storms break out in an office situation. And it becomes a vicious storm, a violent storm, and the world becomes dark around them. And in the midst of it, Jesus comes walking on the stormy waters of controversy. He gets into the argument-filled boat with them, into the office space with them, into life with them. And he calms the storm by probably recognizing what they're going through and talking to them in their own language and talking about things that are real. He calms the storm that is raging within them and among them. And gradually, he gets them through the storm, brings calm, and gets them to the other side of the lake. There, the disciples are dismissed. There, they are no longer in the picture. There, when the gospel story starts to tell what's happening, the disciples are not there anymore. They disappear completely at this point from the narrative of Mark's gospel. When they get to the other side, it's all about Jesus. There's no mention of the disciples. They have gone to have their rest. Jesus has taken over. You go, have your rest. The narrative of the gospel continues, but it is all about Jesus. And Jesus is all alone at this point, completely doing everything. What we have to remember is that this is still all about Jesus. Jesus shares with us his ministry, but at times Jesus says, I need you to have a rest. Jesus shares with all of us some portion of the ministry, and we all have a portion of ministry to do. Some are choir members, some are musicians, some are technical people, some are teachers, some are elders, some are stewards, some are trustees, some are secretaries, some are bulletin folders, some are proofreaders, some are greeters, some are ushers, some are chairs of committees, some are administrators, some are treasurers, some are preachers. God help us if we have too many of them. But none are more or less important than any other. Together, we comprise the body of Christ, the living body of Christ. And in that, everyone is necessary. Ultimately, we have to remember it's all about Jesus. It's not about us. And sometimes Jesus says, you need a break. You need a break. Today, I hear him saying this in many different forms, both to the church and to individuals. Take a break. Restore your soul. Escape the paparazzi. Enjoy the summer because when this passage of the narrative is over, I've got work for you to do. Because when we come back in the fall, when we get back together again in church in the fall, all of you are going to have an important ministry to do. And when the gospel narrative starts off again, you are going to become the living presence of Christ. It's going to depend upon you. I need you rested. I need you prepared. I need you to search your heart and your soul and your mind to find out what ministry is yours. And then we come back in the fall. I need you to say, Jesus, this is what I can do. Not Ivan, this is what I can do. Not the church. No, it's all about Jesus. Jesus, this is what I can do. And then I need you to do it with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your experiences. In the meantime, as we get out of the boat today, remember, the disciples go off to rest. All of you need a rest. Because when you come back in the fall, Jesus is going to need all of us to be involved in some form of ministry. Now, your ministry might be very short-lived when you come back. Maybe the church is going to say, would any of you like to call 5 people and invite them back to church? So you get 5 telephone numbers, you call 5 people and say, hi, church is starting up. Would you like to come back? We'd like to see you back. Maybe you want to plan an event, something you've been missing. Maybe you want to go for a walk with a bunch of church people. Maybe you want to go to Tim Hortons for coffee with a bunch of people. Maybe you want to, whatever you want to, that's what the Spirit is calling you to do. That's what Jesus needs you to do when you come back. I don't know what the disciples were doing when they got to the other side of the lake that day, but I know that they had to have a break. And then, shortly after this in the gospel, they get back to work. But that's the next chapter. In the meantime, they escape the paparazzi for a short period of time. Let us go and do likewise. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray.
Almighty God, let us rest in you. Hold us like I was holding Seamus. Give us peace. Give us comfort. Give us strength. Prepare us for the ministry to which you are calling us, for your glory. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Tamsin, will you lead us in a statement of faith?
We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen.
At this point, let us think of the offerings we would like to make to God. In our hearts and our minds and our souls, let us quietly fill this plate with the offerings we give to God. Let us pray together. Almighty and ever-present God, receive the gifts we offer, both visible and invisible, and use them and us for your glory and the good of all people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now Adam has prepared for us a choral offering. Let us listen to God.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious is that grace upon me, the hour I first believed, through many dangers, toils and toils and snares, I have already come. I have already come. 'Tis grace that God me saved, it does not hurt, and grace. To me, this word my hope secure. God will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures.
When we've been here 10,000 years, bright shine.
Sing God's praise,
and when we
Everything in life is an agreement.
So join us in the communion liturgy. The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, for his continued life with you in glory, and for his being the host of this meal with us in the church. He has taken away the sins of the world and brought us into unity with you. Therefore, we join our voices with the angels and the archangels and all the company of the redeemed to sing your praises. Of the Passover, our Lord set a table with his friends, as he sits at table with us now. He took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Almighty God, we have broken open the body of your word, heard your voice in scripture, recounted your story of redemption, and with Christ are becoming part of your unfolding drama of salvation.
When the meal was finished, Jesus raised his cup. Again he gave you thanks and praise. Then he said to his disciples, "Drink from this cup, all of you. This is the cup of covenant renewal that binds us together in one body with the blood of God flowing in us. Do this in remembrance of me."
Almighty God, we drink from a common cup of memory, and in each of us flows the force of your presence. Strengthen us to do your will and to proclaim our faith.
Loving God,
pour out your Holy Spirit upon our offerings of bread and wine. Grant that they may be for us the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ.
Loving God,
pour out your Spirit on all who share this feast, that we may be for the world the living presence of Christ, serving and reconciling all people to you. Remember your church scattered on the face of the earth.
Gather her in unity and preserve her in truth. Remember our friends who have gone before us into the richness of your presence, especially this day remembering Paul and Sophie and all those whom we remember mention now in silence.
In communion with them and with all creation, we worship and glorify you always.
Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church,
all glory and honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for you, preserve you unto life everlasting. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ's body is always broken for us, and be thankful. This is the cup of a new beginning. It is poured out for you and for me and for many for the forgiveness of all that is past. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for thee, preserve thee to life everlasting. Take and drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood is always shed for us, and be thankful. And now we are one. One with all God's people throughout time, one with all God's people in this world. We are filled with the Spirit for God's glory. Let us pray. Almighty God, may we bear from this table ever mindful of the grace you have poured into each one of us. May we be filled not only with our words, but your words. And may we speak for your glory and act for your glory. In Christ our Lord. Amen. The hymn is Bread of Life, Feed My Soul.
Please join me in the parting prayer. Bless to us, O God, this day, the doors we open, the thresholds we cross, and all the roads that lie before us. Go with us always as we go, and at the close of our day, welcome us home. Let us go to the candle we have, if we have one at home, and I invite you to extinguish it, remembering that the light of Christ is not in candles nor institutions, but within each of us. We are the light of the world. Amen. And will you please join me in the benediction? May the blessing of the Maker be yours,
encircling us, above us, and within us.
May the blessing of the Son be yours,
the wine and the water,
the bread and the stories, to feed us and remind us. May the blessing of the Spirit be yours,
the wind and the fire,
the still small voice of calm, to comfort us and disturb us. May the blessing of God, three in one and one in three, be yours this day and every day,
to protect us,
defend us,
encourage us,
and strengthen us. And may we bless each other, a blessing rooted in our common pilgrimage, the blessing of a friend.
Please turn to those around you, either those present in body or in spirit, and whisper to them the words,
Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Adam, will you lead us in the choral prayer?
Walk with mercy and with God's humble care. When you walk from here, when you walk from here, walk with justice, walk with mercy and with God's humble care.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us for worship. Now we'll have a brief time for announcements for the church community, and from there we'll flow into a time of chat if you want to chat with us. This is the end of the formal worship service. Now for the work of the church. Cheryl is in the office. She will flash up the announcements, the summer announcements. We'll briefly go through them. As you know, we are an inclusive church where all of God's children have a place and all of God's people can find a place to rest and be comforted in God. Wednesday, the devotions for the church will continue, but this Wednesday they're going to be hosted on the United Churches for Dartmouth page. So if you'd like to join in for Wednesday morning devotional, please join the Dartmouth Facebook page for the United Churches for Dartmouth. The website is there. You can easily pick it up. If you're wrestling at all with isolation or loneliness, please give us a call. We'll get back to you as quickly as possible just to have a little bit of a conversation with you and to change the water on the beans. Pastoral care, please, in the summertime, keep us in the loop of what is happening. Soon the restrictions shall be lifted and we'll be able to get back to visiting the hospitals again. Presently, if you're in the hospital or know of somebody in the hospital, you give us a call, we can arrange a visit, but we can only visit them. We can't visit generally in the hospital. So please be conscious of that. The prayer circles of the congregation are there. You see the various names of people. I would like to add to that list the name of Isabel. Please keep Isabel and her family in your care as well. Also during the summertime, as is our usual habit, at 10 o'clock in the morning, no matter where we are, we'll pause and just say, God bless Port Wallis, or think of somebody in the church and whisper a prayer for them. You could be driving down the road, you could be doing a variety of different things. Set your alarm on your phone for 10 o'clock in the morning to be reminded just to say a prayer and to lift the whole congregation together into God's presence in prayer. The small lunch committee. Once again, you can take your recyclables to Blue Nose Recycling Bottle Exchange on 99 Woodlawn Road. And there you say, I'd like the money to go to Port Wallis United Church small lunch account. This has been greatly growing during the pandemic. So thank you for your support. The book sale is there. You can read about what we're going to have in the fall. So if you have those things to offer and you'd like to clean out your shelves a bit and come and refresh the space you have made, please be conscious of that. There's a film series offered by the Region 15 and Region 14 as well called Anti-Racism Summer Film Series. A series of films you can watch at your leisure and then join in a discussion group afterwards to talk about what you heard, what was your understanding from this film. There's the links, easily up there. Please follow them. Great chance to have some good discussion with people around the region. For the offerings of the church, you see there's various ways of doing them. Thank you for your generosity, for your kindness. We're a bit behind because we haven't had some suppers this year, so if you can help, we'd appreciate that. Those are ways you can help. The United Churches for Dartmouth is looking for someone who can do some interesting little videos. So maybe you have a teenager, maybe you are a teenager, and you'd like to put together a bit of a video on a biblical story, call up Mark Hazen and join him. Say, I'd like to do that. He will walk you through some of the technical aspects of that. Also coming up, we're going to call upon Adam here in a second. There's a trivia night, and we all know how we like to deal with trivia. So here's Adam to explain that to you.
Yes, this is our second annual Port Wallis Trivia Night. I wish I had the trophy here with me to show you that there is some real incentive to win. Liz Joyce and family and friends won last year. The trophy's in the mail. So it's going to be pretty much the same time this year. Last year it was July 29th. This year it is July 28th. and it'll be the same format. You can either team up with people physically in your home and log in on Zoom, or we can set you up with people so that you can have kind of like an online table you can discuss answers with. But in any case, if you'd like to sign up for that, that is on the website, and there's just a short little form to fill out. And if you did it last year, it's the exact same format, exact same form. So, yeah, we hope to see you there, July 28th.
Thank you, Adam. So July 28th is a Wednesday evening. So a great way to pass the Wednesday evening, last Wednesday of the month of July, get together with your friends, have a good laugh, join in the trivia, and we know who's going to win. The ukulele church camp you see there is the next announcement for the church community. Great fun, great way to experience church, especially with younger people. Preparing for the fall school term, I realize some of you feel you might be a bit behind in mathematics or chemistry or something like this, physics, basic computer science. We have a person in the congregation who's more than willing to tutor you for a bit over the summer. So if you'd like to do that, please give Stuart a call or an email, and he will walk you through some of the workings of that and bring you up to steam so you can start the next grade well prepared. These are your announcements for the church community. We have an announcement for the week. The deal of the week this week is Post cereal, $1.97 per box, and it's available at Walmart. The food bank needs cereal. It needs a whole lot of things. It needs cereal. I'm glad the offerings came in for last month to go to the North Dartmouth Outreach Center, and I believe there were $660. So that's another way of helping support the church. Make your offering through your e-account through the church that way, and make an offering that way to help reach out and feed the people. But if you want to go and purchase something this week, Walmart Post cereal, $1.97 per box, the deal of the week. And once again, Paul will be here on Wednesday at noon to pick up your blessings for the congregation. These are your announcements. Any further announcements for the community?